In the book, at a key moment when the police had been very cruel to you, you ask, tell me why they do this to us. Is there an answer that you've found?
No, I think back about the old days, you know, it was just the way it was when it's just something entrenched in the culture. Since they, you know, tracked our people down on horses, you know, and walked them, you know, in chains, you know, around the neck, around the arm, you know, hands and around the feet. I don't know if that's part of, you know, people have forgotten that, or they try to. Yeah, there probably are a lot of good police people, I mean, they're good at what they do and their work. But the ones that I met back in the day, they weren't very nice to us.
And down city streets, I will roll.
During your time living on the streets, you met your soulmate, Ruby Hunter. She too was stolen and taken away from her family.
Yeah, she was, yeah.
What was it that drew you to Ruby in the first place?
She talked. She wasn't afraid of just coming up and talking to me. I didn't talk much to anybody, you know, and I was looking, met her in Adelaide, and she just had this way. And even if I didn't talk, you know, she'd just keep talking to me, you know, telling me about herself and telling me about things and telling me about the day, what we were doing the day. Just had this personality that endeared you to her.
Drinking, fighting was no fun.
So while you and Ruby went through difficult times and you had an incredible connection and life, you had an incredible life together, having your two sons and you also took in many foster children as well. What did that mean to you, both of you being children from the stolen generation? What was it like taking in other children, and what did it mean to you?
Some of them were family, you know, nephews. It just seems like it's what you do. It's what uncles and aunties do. You know, it's, you know, if uncles and aunties, you know, start closing their doors to young fellas or to people, you know, shutting the door on people, that'd be a sad day for the culture, for our culture, that's for sure.
Open up your eyes, open up your mind, keep searching for the things you hope to find.
In the book, you say that Open Up Your Eyes was the first song you penned sober.
Yeah. Yeah.
Tell me about that moment when you created it.
We was in a place called Gully Amble in Melbourne. When it first opened, it was a rehab for Aboriginal people, Torres Strait Islander people. And I had a guitar. But I loved poetry since I was a kid. I loved poetry at school, writing, and writing essays or compositions. And so I was sitting in the room one time at Gully Amble, me and Reuben. I'm writing down what I thought was a poem. And I started writing it down, and next minute this melody came into my head as I'm writing. And I stopped, and the more I wrote, the more this melody kept coming back to me. So I picked the guitar up and started playing it to this melody, playing chords, and sang this melody and sang these lyrics, these words that I'd written, and it was a song. Open Up Your Eyes, and blew me away. I thought, hey, surprised myself.
Just open up your eyes, open up your mind, keep searching for the things you hope to find.
So around 1989, I believe you were discovered by Paul Kelly and his guitarist, Steve Connolly.
Steve Connolly, yeah.
Who heard you performing Took the Children Away on the program Blackout.
That's right, that's right.
Said you've got to understand.
Steve had seen Archie singing, they took the children away, and he said, oh, I just saw this, you know, this great song on Blackout. By this guy called Archie Roach. we should get him for the concert hall. It was one of the most powerful performances I'd ever seen. You could hear a pin drop in the room.
Yes, I came.
So you were then asked to open several shows for Paul Kelly. Tell me about your relationship with him and how that formed.
Once I got to meet him and that, Paul's people got in touch with me, said, could you come down to the concert hall to open Paul Kelly's set? I sang two songs that night, Beautiful Child, about deaths in custody, and Took the Children Away.
Oh, my beautiful child. My beautiful child, the brightest of stars, couldn't match your sweet smile.
After Beautiful Child, this big audience of people, it was quiet. Didn't hear anything, crickets. And second song was Took the Children Away. And for a little while, there was still nothing, just quiet as. And I started to walk away, and the next, they all started cheering and clapping, and that stopped me in my tracks, and I come around and I said, yeah. Paul Kelly eventually came around, and Steve Connolly. Me and Ruby were looking after this, or Ruby was really looking after the family grouper with kids that were state ward kids. And they came around and asked me if I wanted to do an album. You know, he said his record company was interested. He says, if you've got any more songs, Archie, you know, like Took the Children Away and Beautiful Child, we're wondering if you'd like to do an album. At first, I didn't want to do it.
What changed your mind?
Ruby Hunter.
She was very convincing.
So when they left, I sat there and I turned to Ruby and I said, I don't think I want to do it. And she says, why? I said, it's not really me, you know. It says, just happy singing around the community there and here and there, wherever I can. And she put her hands on her hips and looked at me. And then she said, first thing she said, well, you know, it's not all about you, Archie Roach. I'll never forget it to this day. As long as I live, I'll never forget it. And I know what she meant. When we shine, when we do something excellent and good, and we shine and people see that, you know, it's not just about us, it's about our people. Our people shine as well.
So she really made you think about all of that, and she convinced you then to record the first album, which was, of course, Charcoal Lane. And it was a huge success.
It was.
And in particular, Took the Children Away, which, of course, was the first song on the album, about the forcible removal of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander children from their families.
Yeah.
Firstly, tell me about the writing of that song and what it meant to you.
Snatched from their mother's breast, said this is for the best, took them away.
I started writing songs like, you know, Open Up Your Eyes, which was more or less a country tune, really. And, you know, then you write a few other country songs.
At 15 I left my foster home, looking for the people I call my own.
I finally got in touch with my people and my family where my mother's from, Framlingham. Went there one time and Uncle Banjo was one of my mentors and uncles. He came up to me one time and asked me, you write songs, don't you, boy? I go, yeah, Unc. Well, I try. He said, why don't you write a song about when you was taken away? I said, I don't remember much about it. And he looked at me and he said, yeah, I do, though. And we sat down and he told me a story over a cup of tea. You know, our dad come running from the river and looking to fight the Gunji ones, the policemen, and the welfare. And the day that we were taken. And so I sat down and that night I started writing the song and finished it by next morning, got up and finished it. I went around to Uncle Banjo's and sung it to him. Yeah.
And what was his response when you sang it to him?
He just looked at me and go, yeah, that's him, my boy, that's him.
Send us off to foster homes. As we grew up, we felt alone, cause we were acting white, yet feeling black. One sweet day, all the children came back,
the children came back.